Good afternoon for everyone from Australia. My talk is the manipulation of internal chemistry of electrode materials for energy storage and conversion. So what I will cover in this talk is a little bit about what my group is doing, and then some nanomaterials for catalysis, some nanostructures for energy conversion, and some 2D materials for mechano-electrical energy conversion. I will discuss like how we can develop innovative materials, how we can play with their structure, with their composition, and the surface chemistry to make them effective towards energy storage, producing hydrogen, or converting mechanical energy into electrical energy. So what basically my group is doing, my group is expert in developing and synthesizing different kind of materials. We mainly use three approaches. The first is a liquid metal based approach, and the second is a wet chemistry based synthesis, and then the physical approaches. Most of you know that all these techniques have different impacts on the materials, their properties, and there is a different viability to control them. Like in liquid metal based synthesis, we can produce a large quantity of ultra thin, a large area 2D sheets. Through wet chemistry, we can produce a mass quantities of the materials, especially for energy storage and conversion applications. And then through physical approaches, we can develop very fine materials for electronic applications. So what we do here is mainly apply these materials into energy storage, like into batteries that can be lithium, sodium, potassium batteries, or supercapacitors, or the hybrid supercapacitors, or hydrogen or oxygen evolution reactions for water splitting, or piezoelectric or thermoelectric applications. Then we also do explore some of these materials for as a biocompatible for the in vitro or in vivo early disease detections, like MRI, drug delivery, and some of the toxicology applications. We also apply these materials for the wastewater treatment and microwave absorption. Because we develop some porous materials, we develop some hybrid integrated nanostructures which have a large interfacial connections which can be applied in these applications. So our facilities, if you look, we have a very high quality facilities, and everyone is welcome if someone want to use these facilities where we develop these materials, integrate them into a different devices, and then apply them in a different applications. So I will now directly start from my to build the story towards my talk. You know that what we are doing, we are burning a lot of fossil fuels, and that fossil fuels are impacting our environment very, very badly. So these are the photos that you can look at the screen are from two of the big cities. One is a Beijing and another is a London. If you look at them, they are highly polluted. So if we are looking in such a living in such an environment, what we need to do, we need to wear mask all the time. So these pictures are not from the COVID-19, keep in mind. These are well before that one. So if we humans may bear the wearing a mask, but what about the animals? Do we also need to put a mask on the animals so they can survive? I don't think so. This is a solution that we can survive in such a way. So what we need to do, we need to get rid of these fossil fuels. We need to get rid of carbon emissions. So if we can get rid of these carbon emissions, we can clean our environment. But for that, what we need to do, we need to develop alternative methods of producing energy. One of them is hydrogen as a green fuel. So that's the best option that we can utilize. We can produce hydrogen from water, and when we use it, its product is water. So there is no carbon emissions. So it's completely a green, but it will be green when we are using it, producing it from the green. So currently, as we know that we are producing a lot of carbon dioxide, so this increasing our temperature of the earth due to global warming. So what's the possible solution, as I mentioned, is only producing hydrogen. So, but currently whatever hydrogen we are producing, 96% of that is directly or indirectly based on fossil fuels. It means we are still producing a lot of carbon emissions. So if we want to reduce that one, that is depending on the water splitting. And water splitting, that is also based on the renewable energy sources, like we are utilizing power from the wind power, solar, tide, or some other source of a renewable energy. And we are converting using that one and convert the water into hydrogen, then using that hydrogen as a fuel, then it means we are reducing completely carbon emissions. But that hydrogen production is only a 4%. So if we really want to get rid of these carbon emissions, we need to change this 96 into water splitting, and that 4 maybe on fossil fuels. So then we can have the least impact of carbon emissions on our environment. So what challenges with water splitting we have? So there are a lot of challenges. Like, of course, basically water splitting is the two reactions. One is oxygen evolution reactions on the anode side, and on the cathode side we have a hydrogen evolution reactions. So these two reactions have to be very efficient. So if they are, they will be efficient and they should be in the same electrolyte. But what happens, we need a lot more energy than what make it efficient. So to reduce that one, we need a catalyst. But catalysts have their own problems. They have a stability problem. They have their preferences to work in a specific electrolytes. Might be OER based catalyst, they are preferred to be in alkaline, and the HER based, they are preferred to work in acidic mediums. So we can't apply these two different mediums in a single cell. So we need to make some materials that are capable to perform well in the same medium, whether the HER materials, they can perform well in alkaline, whether the OER-based catalyst can perform well in a acidic. So then we can have a one acid-based electrolyzers or a base alkaline-based electrolyzers, or might be if we can have some neutral electrolyte, that is also good. Or something else what we can do, we can also make some bifunctional materials. So even then their mechanism, their kinetics can be fast, make them faster during the conversion of the water into hydrogen. So these are the challenges. We do did some efforts to produce some catalysts for both OER and HER that can make them effective to catalyze the water in a single system. So our journey start with the metal oxides, because we know that metal oxides are very good in developing effective metal oxides, can make a OER reaction very fast. So first we start with the nickel and cobalt based metal oxides. What we did, we bring nickel oxide and cobalt oxide with in the vicinity to each other. We put them together in a single system, but they're individual oxides. So when we did their structural analysis, if you look at the exhaust graphs here, these exhaust graphs shows that when nickel and cobalt oxide, they come close to each other, they are increasing their valence states, like cobalt from +2 to +3, and nickel is also in a higher oxidation state. So when we are getting their higher oxidation state, that we also confirm from the XPS analysis, which are really beneficial for the a catalytic process, especially for OER. When we apply them, we found that they are exceptionally good, even better than the ruthenium oxide or iridium oxide. And their stability is exceptional. Their rate kinetics is very good. But what's the challenge? Challenge is to produce such a catalyst at a large scale. We can't do them at a large scale because it's very difficult to put all these nickel cobalt oxide very finely with each other when we want to produce a mass scale. If we can't produce mass scales, we can't put these catalysts into the industrial applications. So then we thought that it means the main aim of our study is to bring a higher oxidation state of transition metal in their oxide. How we can do that? We need to think something alternative. So what we did, we apply another plasma treatment. Through that plasma treatment, we create a metal vacancies. So when we create metal vacancies, we found that we are producing, we are producing higher amount of higher oxidation state in our oxides. So like when we bring one cobalt out, we found the remaining over there has a higher CO plus 3 contents in the system rather than CO plus 2 and CO plus 3 both. So as we are creating a vacancies, we are producing better and better catalysts. We did some DFT studies showed that such a defects or vacancy sites where we produce that vacancy, they are very favorable for the water to be adsorbed over there and have the conversion reactions occur over there. Ultimately, we did some characterization again with the EXAF, because EXAF is very good to determine the local structure of our elements in a material. So we found that when we produce such a vacancy over there, it is creating higher oxidation state of metals over there. So with such a higher oxidation state, we are making a highly functional materials. Then we try them to use as a OER catalyst. If you look here, we treat this at the different temperature, different plasma conditions, 300, 500, 700, and we found that the 700 one and is not that good because we create a lot of vacancies over there, which is creating distortion in the structures. But 300 one is very optimized and much better than the, again, the radium and ruthenium oxide. So that give us the confidence that by tuning the internal structure, manipulating with the materials configurations, changing their oxidation states, we can produce materials which can be scalable, which can be a very good and very efficient to produce oxygen and very stable and have a high reaction kinetics. So we learn a lot how we can develop better OER catalysts, but the challenge with the HER. But in case of HER, oxides are not that good. So we move to the phosphides. We found that phosphides are very good. So we apply a simple method to produce 2D metal phosphides, because 2D give us the more options, more active sites available on the planar surface as well as on edges. So we have a higher number of active sites, and our electrodes are enriched with the active sites, so we can have a faster reaction kinetics. So we apply them and we test them. We found that they are good, but still are challenges with the stability of these materials. Their conductivity is low, and we are not getting that much good performances. However, we found that if we are, it's not only that porosity are can bring a more active sites. It's basically the internal structure of the phosphide and the ratio of the phosphide that give us the better structure. Like we did some of the electrochemical surface area measurements on the nanosheets and nanonet, and we found that nanosheets with the micro pores, then the nanonets are more, have a more active sites on the surface. So it means only having a higher surface BET surface area is not a guarantee that you will get a higher active sites exposed to the electrolyte. So mean you have to control them in such a way that they are not only exposed, but they are also accessible by the electrolyte. And then we tried to make a system that can work very well for overall water splitting. So we design another metal phosphide which has a ring-like structure, and at the ring structure, when the ring forms at the surface ring, where ring is forming at that place, atoms are highly intense. So their energies are very much different than the bulk of that material. So in a ring, every point is a ring. So every point becomes an active site. So they are become very, very active towards OER, towards HER. And further what we did, we treat the surface to make us some phosphide on the surface. So when we are making some phosphide on the surface, that phosphate makes a little bit more stable and tune the electronic structure. If you look at the band structure, that give us the idea that how the phosphate are bringing the gap between anode and cathode to the theoretical ideal value of the material. So when we apply this material as a full water splitting catalyst, both as anode and cathode, if you look at this figure, it give us the best result presented to date in all phosphide based materials, even somewhere where we have some of the noble metals doped over there. So this give us idea, like if you want to develop a better catalyst, you have to control their structure, you have to control their surface, you have to control their composition, so that you have every element perfectly placed over there, and then you have to maximize the active sites so that you can utilize maximum of your material to achieve the best performance. So that what we did in our last example, and we achieved the best outcome out of it. And we are still continuously developing these materials. We are also doing some of the heteroatom dopings in them to make them more functional. And now we are moving towards the seawater catalysis. If I got chance later on, I will show some of those examples as well. So now I will move towards some examples toward the electrical energy storage, that is the batteries. So we know that currently we have a different kind of energy storage systems. Some of them is a fuel cells, which are very high energy density, but they suffer from the poor power densities. Then we have some of the traditional capacitors, which shows very high power densities, but suffer from the poor energy densities. I mean, they can deliver the energy very quickly, but they store very tiny amount of energy. So that's not sufficient to drive something. So then batteries appear. So batteries like lithium ion battery, sodium ion battery, or potassium ion battery, they have a very, very high energy density as well as a power density, but still not sufficient. What we need for future, our future aims, we need something energy density which are close to 600, 700. We need power densities which are close to, not surpassing the supercapacitors, but traditional capacitors, but still are almost similar to the supercapacitors. So then we can have a long electric car drives. We can have our short flights by the planes, or even we can try to reach the completely carbon emission free Boeing flights as well. So all these like lithium battery, sodium battery, potassium battery, all those batteries store their energy in a three basic mechanisms. One is the ionic storage, that is a that called a metal ion battery. Then we have some of the air batteries like lithium air battery, sodium air battery, zinc air battery, and we also have some sulfur batteries, that's the lithium sulfur batteries. All these batteries have their own challenges, like in ionic batteries, when ions goes inside the electrode and come back, they create a volume expansion, structural changes, so we need to manipulate that kind of interior structure of the materials. In air batteries, catalyst like OER and ORR, both are happening there, so both have the challenges to be overcome. And then in sulfur batteries, the main challenge is the polysulfide shuttle. So that is creating a huge problem and deteriorating the performance of the battery. So that need to be overcome. So in my examples, I will only cover a little bit about the ionic batteries like a lithium or sodium ion batteries. As I mentioned that what's the problem with the ionic batteries, when the ions, what we need to store, when they move into the electrode, to get stored over there, they create a volume changes over there. They create some structural changes over there. They create some compositional changes over there. So then different kind of geometries of these electrode materials start growing. So one is the first, they think that if we increase the surface area, we can maximize the storage at the surface. But that brings the challenge of thick SCA formation, many side reactions. Then they start making nanowires. That nanowires can also overcome a little bit side reactions, can control the SCA film, but the results are not that much promising. Then we move towards their composite with 2D materials, but still, and then recently we jump into the 3D nanostructures, and 3D in such a way that we make that 3D structure from a 0D, put that 0D into a separate shell and then combine them into a one 3D structure. So such a 3D structures have a dual protection. They have some volume compensation elements inside, so they can give us a better and better possibilities to have a higher energy storage, have a longer cycle life, have a high power and energy densities. So I will give a few examples about this. So that we also tried, first thing, we know that nanoparticles having a high surface area create side reactions and their low conductivity creating a problem. So we put them on a graphene, and graphene is a nitrogen dope, so it's a high conductivity and particles are over there. But still these particles can react with the electrolyte and can create a high thick surface or thick SCA film on the film formation. So what we did, we protect the surface. If you look at this schematic, we protect each individual particle with the cobalt shell. Cobalt is an inert metal, so it will not react with the electrolyte. So it can minimize the formation of a SCA film. And then it is also very strong. So it can also accommodate the any volume changes occurring between tin alloy inside the core. So it is providing us very good stability. If you look at the graphs and if you look at charge-discharge mechanism, we are not looking a lot of formation of the SCA film in the subsequent cycles, that we can control that SCA film formation. But one challenge, because as I mentioned, cobalt is an inert here. So when cobalt is an inert here, it means it's not contributing towards the capacity. It's a dead material in the battery. So dead material means we are losing our gravimetric capacity over there when we want to scale it up. So how we can accommodate that one? So we thought that our aim is to have some strong shell that can stop the excessive access to the electrolyte, as well as it should be towards a little bit porous, so it is also have a some sort of insertion capability of the ions can come inside and store over there without any having any chemical reaction, without any having any impact on the volume changes of the material. So that is the graphitic structure, graphitic carbons, which are very strong. So that can cover the surface. So, and secondly, to utilize maximum of the particle, we did some engineering inside the particle. We make a different kind of alloy and then combine them at the these grain boundaries become the tunnels for the ions to move inside. And then this graphitic structure is protecting the surface. So these tunnels, when these particles, instead of from here to move, they can move through these tunnels very quickly. And then from these tunnels, they can move into the every point where they can get stored. So it means the particle is not expanding at one point, it is expanding overall. So we can have a some through the carbon, we can have a control over that one. And consequently, we are getting very, very high performance. And if you look at their performance and especially charge rate capabilities, as we are increasing the power, performance still remains, of course it's reducing, but it remains stable. And once we bring it back, it quickly come back to the original position, because we are reaching, we are sending the ions to individual active sites through the tunnels. So the rate can be controlled very quickly, because there is a they don't need to diffuse a long distance. So if the ions need to diffuse a long distance, then their rate is impacting. So in this way, we are not only increasing the performance, we can also increasing their rate, and we are making them more effective in a certain conditions where we need to apply brakes, sudden we need up and down in the power consumption. So these kind of materials are very useful for that purpose. And then my last example towards the batteries, that's the multi-layer designing of a high aerial capacity in sodium ion batteries. Because sodium ion, of course, is a very big ion as compared to the lithium ion. So if when it move into the electrode, it create more volume changes. So we need even further engineering in the electrode materials that we can accommodate then. So we bring a concept that we have a carbon nanotubes foam, and we decorate our material on carbon nanotubes. If you look at MOSC2 here, and then we further coat that MOSC2 with again with a carbon, following our previous concept, and then we are blocking the direct contact of the electrolyte with the MOSC2, and then we are also making MOSC2 layered structure. So that is a have a more space available to get the more ion store over there. And secondly, it's a foam structure, so it can be compressed to make the highly dense material, so that we can have a more aerial capacities in the minimum size. So that is also increasing ultimately gravimetric capacity of the material. So the design is very simple. If you look at the schematic, it's explaining clearly that how we put the different kind of materials on top of each other to get the final product, which is a very, very what we call soft in structure, so that you can put as much as you want to put your material in the cell, even in the coin cell, to get the maximum aerial capacities or maximum gravimetric capacities. So I will move towards a few examples toward the electrical mechano-electrical conversion. So mechano-electrical conversion, everyone knows that if we have materials which can be polarized by the mechanical force, they can create a potential at their edges, and from that potential we can create the power, so that power can be utilized for several applications, a huge number of applications. We can develop a nano generators that can be utilized as a pacemakers. We can have a nano generators for the remote sensing. We can have a nano generators to in our wearable like shoes. Even we can put them in our as a sensor in our cars. We can put them as a sensor in the buildings. We can put them as a sensor to sense the any sudden environmental change, like some earthquakes are coming. So we can detect all of that kind of stuff using these kind of piezoelectric materials. So zinc oxide is one of the very most studied material for the one of the most studied non-PZT material for the piezoelectric applications. But we know that when we are reducing the thickness of zinc oxide, normally what happens, we believe that when we're reducing the thickness of any 2D materials, its performance or its output can be increased. So here what we did, we also assume the same thing, that if we are reducing the thickness of a zinc, we can also improve its output, when what we, if you look at the left side of the images, when we reduce the thickness from like already there's a reports for a 2 nanometer, that 2 nanometer zinc is showing some performance, but when we bring it less than 2 nanometer, 1.63 or 0.94 or 0.47, we are looking at there's a no output, there's a no polarization occurs. We feel that there's a no possibility to further extend the or further increase the performance of the zinc oxide. Then we found that why not if we have another material on the bottom or some functionalization of our substrate that can induce some changes in the structure of the zinc oxide when it's ultra thin, so that can give us a high performance. So we did the same thing. We put that these ultra thin zinc oxide sheets on the SiO2. When they make a connection with the SiO2, you see they get polarized, and we found that this kind of polarization is creating a large current output, a large power out of these things. And then we try to realize this structure. So simply we apply our liquid metal approach, simply melt the zinc, and then we apply that one on tin oxide, and you see we can produce the centimeter and long continuous sheets. We characterize these sheets. They are highly crystalline. They are a unidirectional growth. They are ultra thin, and they are a crystalline by XRD. We did some XPS studies, and we found that there is a connection existing between the zinc oxide and the silicon dioxide. That's a covalent bond forms. So that covalent bond is basically is creating a polarization, creating a dipoles in the zinc oxide. When we test their PFM studies, we found that as we are increasing potential, you see you can easily clearly see the phase changes happening with the materials, and the coefficient D33 coefficient found is 80 picometer volt. That is almost 8 times larger than the bulk ZnO. If you look at this graph, bulk ZnO and then the 1.1 nanometer thin sheets, and we find something very strange. From 1.1, when we reduce further, its performance is reducing, and for further increasing, performance is again reducing. We found that 1.1 is the optimum thickness of the zinc oxide that can give us the best output. And then we extend the similar. We found that tin sulfide is another interesting material, but to getting ultra thin tin sulfide or a monolayer of tin sulfide is not possible, because when we are reducing in the traditional methods, when we're synthesizing this material by mechanical or by wet chemistry, it's get oxidized. So we don't have any stable structure of tin sulfide. We again apply our liquid metal approach in presence of instead of oxygen. In case of zinc oxide, here we apply sulfur dioxide, and we try to get the tin sulfide, and we found tin sulfide ultimately in our substrate. And when we characterize that tin sulfide, it clearly shows it's the SnS, not SnS2. It's not getting oxidized, it's not losing its structure. It's very ultra thin. If you look at the TM, if you look at AFM, and it's a very crystalline if you look at their HRTM and SAAD images. Then we tried, okay, this is the interesting material, we are getting it. Then we again did the PFM study, and we found that it's again giving us a phase change and a good piezoelectric coefficient. Then we try, like, okay, we are now developing some materials which are very good, which are giving us a good PFM outcomes. Will they be useful when we apply them as nano generators? We try to put some force on them by in a sequence. We found that when we put a continuous force, they are very stable. They are giving a very high outputs, around 200 millivolt. And when we put them on our fingers, just relax and bend it, you see the output. Output is very high. So it means we can simply, through this technique, we can prepare a roll-on-roll method. We can print large sheets of tin sulfide or zinc oxides, make their devices, just simply apply them. So it means if just a finger can produce that much force, if we are jogging and we're putting this material under our shoes, how much energy we can produce? We can produce a lot of energy. Like its power is milliwatt, around 25 milliwatt per meter square. That's a very huge power from a nano generator point of view. If we are having this kind of devices under our feet, we can produce a lot of power that can power our cell phones, that can power off any remote and medical device that we have along with us. So these can be very useful for that kind of things. So that's all about the piezoelectric. In a summary, I believe that structure and composition strongly influence the electrochemical properties of electron materials. If we have a good control over structure, we have a good control over composition, we can have a materials which can mitigate their limitations, and we can have our materials which perform very well in any device. Further, through nanostructuring and tuning of chemistry of a molecular level, electron materials may introduce a new concept of energy storage that can give birth to a new technologies like a hybrid ion capacitors. We have a lot of hydrogen proton batteries. So these are all the new concepts which are emerging with when we are moving and we are playing with our materials. So at the end, I would like to acknowledge my PhD students and my research associates, as well as my collaborators and most important different funding sources who fund us to give to do all this research. And at the end, I will say thanks to everyone for listening my talk. And if you have any questions, you can ask, you can contact me through my email. If you want to work with us, you can still drop us an email. Welcome.